Hey guys, so welcome to another screencast on OpenShift. So we've already installed additional repositories or additional RPMs repository. We've set up an NTP server to synchronize the time between the broker and the node. We've basically run a couple of kind of checks. So what the screencast will cover is the sort of like running the diagnostic tools, and basically if on the broker and the node they have different diagnostic tools, basically you can just type OO in our tab and you see all the kind of utility tools you have to do a lot of diagnostics. We're going to use the OO diagnostics, the OO broker, and the OO MCO ping. Feel free to use some of these ones. They are well documented, so you can just type the name and it should give you some documentation on them. And on the node as well, the node will have its own set of OO commands. You can see you have more of this on the node than the broker. This is because they're a little bit different. All right, so in this case, what I want to do now is to kind of run the OO diagnostics command, and I'm going to specify a couple of V's here. This is just to give us an output of the command, and I can assure you that we will have one or two warnings or errors, and the idea is so that we can run it and fix it as the as we move along. So I'm going to run the OO diagnostics here and run the OO diagnostics here as well. Right, so we've gotten our first share here. You can see that SNX has logged some warnings in the audit file, so we need to check that. We can see a couple of errors actually, so we can make sure we fix that as well. All right, and of course, the beauty with the OO tools is that they give you suggestions on how to kind of fix some of the errors. So in this case here, you can see that we could not get the SNX context for odd job D. I like the fact that we're getting these errors. I'm going to show you how to fix the errors, and then just in case you encounter some of them in the future, just know that you can fix them as well. All right. Alright, so also this might take some time, so we're gonna allow this to run and kind of look at the output and fix the bugs as we move along. Okay, so we have a bunch of reds and whatever color this is. Basically this we're gonna tackle this one after the other. So we're going to start with the node. Now if you notice on the broker, I had to cancel it. I noticed it stalled for quite some time, and usually that means there's a problem. So let's start with the node. So for instance, the test SNX is enabled path. Here you can see that the following changes should be made to SNX file context. So incorrect contexts are likely to cause problems with OpenShift operations. So please review and apply restcon. That's restore con then the file. In this case, so this is what it wants us to do. Basically it wants us to do restore con on our server file. So let's go ahead and do that. All right, on the server file itself. So yep, and of course the context is set to whatever this is, SLinux. All right, I'm not a SLinux expert, so don't judge. All right, so here you can see that we're having some problems. We detected some warnings on the audit file. So usually it'd be nice to just truncate the audit file so that when it runs, it doesn't see it again. But what you should do is when you reboot the machine or when you use it for some time, you want to also make sure that you run OO diagnostics again to be sure that it's not logging this file. For me, I think the log came from previously when it was installing some of the packages. We can verify that later anyway. All right, so that was this part. Initially what I did was I thought the system gave me a command that looks like this, and kind of that's what I thought. the problem was. So when I did this, I got an error. Let me just show you. And yeah, I got an error. All right, so reset failed, no such file directory and so on. So that's why I did this, if you're wondering. All right, so once we've done that, next step here is you can see the O accept node had errors. So C groups can't be listed, C group is not mounted. So when you see this error, usually you shouldn't panic. It means you've not started some services. So it's telling you to start some services here. All right, so the first one we're going to start. All right, and the second one here, we're also going to start. And just to be sure, you want to make sure they start on boot as well. So cg config and cg red. All right, so now the next thing you want to see is this part that says service or job D. Anyway, here it says service or job D not running. So what you want to be sure, you have to be sure that you have the message bus service running, so, or installed. So in this case, I want to grab message bus, and yeah, you can see message bus is installed. So just go ahead and start it. Service message bus start, and you want to make sure that it comes on boot as well. Anyway, so it does come on boot, so basically you can see the run levels. So now I have to do this part. All right, yeah, so the next thing here you can see here is you know, device not found. So that is ETH0. For some reason, device not found. So anyway, we're going to run it and see if it comes up again. Now, the next set of errors is this manifest. Actually, OpenShift can't read the manifest of the cartridges. Usually, you want to just restart the Ruby mCollective package. So to do that, you just type service Ruby 193 mCollective. And you restart it, and yeah, so you can see here for some reason this warning is showing here, and I noticed the warning has also shown here in the mCollective part as well. So for some reason there's a deprecated option that has not been updated in the OpenShift option. So anyway, this option will be ignored and should be removed from this. So let's see if we can fix that. Otherwise, we leave it as is. So the topic prefix, let's go ahead and comment this and restart the service. All right, and let's quickly jump, since we have the same error here. Let's quickly jump here and kind of do this as well. And yeah, so moving on. So here, the following service are not currently started, so I believe we've started them. And the following service are not started at boot time, so OpenShift Watchman. So let's ensure that it comes up on boot. So chk config save on. And now this part here that says using system config firewall and lock it with OpenShift is not recommended. So I want to kind of ensure that this is not installed. So I'm just going to go ahead and do a sort of like a yum remove. Let's see if this will spike any dependency problems. If it does, then we can go ahead and find a way to improvise. All right, so once while that's doing here, let's jump to the node. So let's truncate the audit file as well. Right, so audit.log. So here I did the wrong file. All right, so my bad. All right, so This, for some reason, I know is wrong. The one I did earlier, but the reason why I'm not freaked about it is because, you know, so system config firewall, let's see if that is installed. The reason why I'm not freaked out here is because I'm going to go ahead and copy the audit rules here as well and paste it back then. Right, so no package for removal. Right, so again to improvise, so let me ensure that if there were any rules that we restored back, and it was, so right, so so node unavailable. We're going to go ahead and run the test again, this time around to be sure that we fix the problems. Here you can see that we have the RPM package one configuration files have been altered. You can see the etsy cgconfig.com, the RPM new. So you want to make sure that you know, you've removed this file. Means we have two of them. Right, and right, just to be sure we have everything covered. Yep. Right, so so to continue using Lockheed, please ensure the following custom rules are installed in etsy sysconfig. So I'm just going to go ahead and add these rules. This is for completeness, since we can't find the firewall rules sort of. So okay, just to be sure that it has that in there. All right, so there's also a warning here saying that our environment variable for the broker host is pointing to localhost, meanwhile the one in the node.com file is pointing to broker.ml.local. Right, so this should be the correct one, so let's go ahead and update that. So let's see, OpenShift environment and OpenShift broker host, and instead of this should point to our proper broker host. Alright, so hopefully we've covered, tried to fix quite a lot of them. So I'm just going to go ahead and run the OO diagnostics again. Alright, so we still have this messages popping up. Alright, so previously we had 3 errors and 8 warnings, and this time around we have 4 warnings and 1 errors. So which means we fixed some problems. All right, so we need to start these packages, and we need to ensure that for some reason those rules are, you know, installed. All right, so one more thing here, notice that we're using the virtual host in the SSL config directory. Recommending that we comment that. All right, so we've done that. And all right, so context for odd job, so we're going to go ahead and start this as well. So service odd job start chk odd job on, make sure it starts on boot. And the other one here is the OpenShift watchman, so service OpenShift watchman, and right, so hopefully that will reduce the number of warnings and errors we have here as well. Is the anyway, still having problems with the interface information here. So anyway, let's go ahead and run our diagnostics again. So hopefully, apart from the SO Linux errors, okay, and the firewall error, you can see we've reduced the warnings to 2. I'm just going to go ahead and keep hitting this. But one thing I want to also check is the all accept node had errors, and I'm guessing it's the node configuration file. Right, so let's check the etsy OpenShift node.com file and see if we have used something that was pointing to at 0. I'm going to come and check some of these configurations later, but for now we're just going to leave it as is. Right, so here we have instance ID, right? So whatever we put here, right? And for some reason I'm going to check the list and ensure that we don't have any right, we don't. So I'm wondering where the system config file rules came in. Right, can't seem to find it. All right, so don't bore you and waste much of your time as well. I'm just going to leave this as is, and let's see how I can fix the one in the broker as well. So let's run the OO diagnostics here. Okay. All right, so it's running, it's checking. Okay, so we don't seem to have any violations of the logs. Okay, so let's run our diagnostics on both. And here we don't have any logs. Right, so we just have this, which is a warning and one error. Okay, I think we can live with that. And some reason we keep getting this interface. Anyway, I'm going to troubleshoot this behind the scenes, and I'll let you know what I did. But for now, I think our repos, our cartridges, kind of have not been has not been installed, sort of. So for some reason it's not recognizing the Ruby restart. So let's try that one more time. Service Ruby 193m collective restart, and let's try that one more time. So right, so we have two warnings here and we still have the violations. Alright, I'm also going to investigate the violations in this case, so I can see the violations is happening with the net depth at 0. I think that's why we haven't we're missing the information here. Alright, so let's check how our broker is doing. So it's still waiting on the node profiles here, mCollective. So, alright. Anyway, before I go behind the scenes, let me just kind of try to install the cartridges, because sometimes if you have to do that as well. So to install the cartridges, you can use the OO install admin cartridge command. So if you just press enter here, you should see documentation of how it works. So what I want to do now is to kind of specify dash A option and tell it that I want to install the cartridges, and I want to be recursive, so I'm going to install from a list of directories, and I need to specify the source. Of course, feel free to kind of install one package at a time if you want, but in this case I'm just going to be a recursive installation. So So you can see here that for the recursive mode, source is assumed to point to a directory containing cartridge directories. So the cartridge directories in OpenShift is inside the OpenShift USR libexec OpenShift cartridges directory, and we have all those we have all the cartridges inside that. So I'm just going to type that, and you can see that the installation succeeded. Just to be sure, let's restart our mcollective and run the OO diagnostic command again. Hopefully it finds the cartridges now, right? And it did notice the errors. These errors have gone away. So yeah, so that's how to fix that as well. And yeah, you can see basically we had to install the cartridges and make sure it was available. So the check right now should give us no errors. Yay. And we just have two warnings. So I'm going to investigate the warnings and come back and see if it still shows. I'm going to let this go through and come back when the when we have more information for you. Okay guys, so I kind of investigated more about some of the warnings and errors we got during diagnostics on the node. And the first problem actually was the ETH0 error that was showing earlier. So I kind of noticed that because I cloned, you know, the VM images, for those of you that use VMware VirtualBox, while cloning, you notice that the system will regenerate a new MAC address. So the system could not find the ETH0 interface. So all I had to do was to remove the UDEV file that's been reported here in the rules. And after removing that, I kind of went ahead and edited the network configuration file for the network scripts for the ETH0 interface, and kind of copied the MAC address and made sure that the MAC address matched. And after that, I had to reboot the system, and when it came back, it fixed the problem. Now, I noticed also that we had a warning about using system config firewall, and I tried to search for system config firewall earlier, as you noticed. The actual package that has the system config firewall is locate, and all I had to do was to remove it, because it was, as mentioned, it's not recommended when we do OpenShift. So I typed the yum remove the locate package, and now we're gonna run the OO diagnostics tool again. So hopefully this will fix most of the bugs. All right, so you can see that, well, we're still getting the warning for some reason, and I actually added that, if you remember, I actually added the rules here. So I think it's anyway, it's a warning, we can ignore that basically. And I think there was an issue that was raised regarding this, that no matter what happens, it still shows this warning. And the person in charge, the person that wrote this test, actually said that you know, it's by design anyway, so it's fine to ignore that. But if you're paranoid like me, then this will keep disturbing you. But for now, it means you know, we're good to go here with no errors. So now we move on to the broker, and hopefully you can see here that the application failed to connect to the active MQ server. So let's go ahead and use the diagnostics VB command and the broker. All right, so hopefully let's go ahead and complete the test. Okay, so far so good. Just checking the node profiles via the mcollective package. Okay, so I kind of I went ahead and investigated some of the problems, because I noticed that the ActiveMQ implementation was not installed, which is weird. I've been installing OpenShift Origin using the OO installer, and so far I've been having, I've not had this problem before, so this is new to me, as well as I'm sure some of you guys out there. The ActiveMQ client was installed on the broker, but not the ActiveMQ itself, and so the logs for, if I can bring that up quickly, OpenShift node, so I was getting this error, wasn't able to connect to the stump, and that is why the OO diagnostics and the broker was failing. So after investigating it, I noticed that the broker, the ActiveMQ was not installed on the broker. So I went ahead and did a yum, install of the ActiveMQ package. So this, and went ahead and pulled down the package with all of our dependencies like Java, OpenJDK, and so on. All right. So after the installation, unfortunately, since the installation did not configure this for us, we have to go into the ActiveMQ directory ourselves and make some changes. All right. So I have on this page, on the OO deployment guide, comprehensive guide. We're gonna do it manual installation and see if that works. So we've installed the ActiveMQ client. Now what we need to do is to back up the ActiveMQ.xml file and kind of pull down some templates. So I've opened the templates already. We can just copy and paste, or we can just save the files. We can just save them in desktop here and save both files. All right, so what I will do now on the broker now is to kind of create a backup of the ActiveMQ XML file, and all right, so I can call this the same thing here, and I'm going to open the where I save the files. So. So I'm just going to go ahead and copy this and paste it. And we need to check for some things. By default, it listens to 61613 for the stomp. So what we want to ensure we've done here, accordingly, is to change some options here. So for instance, you can see that for the authentication user, you can see the mCollective password. We need to set that, and we need to also set the admin authentication password accordingly. So I'm going to show you where we can find that in a bit. And there's one more section here that is dedicated to the broker. So let me not save this. Let me ensure that wrapping is enabled. So I'm going to use the dash W option here and paste this file again. Hopefully this time it doesn't really wrap all the contents here. Badly. Okay, so all right, so hopefully this doesn't broker bit of our configuration here. All right, so what we want to ensure we have set correctly here is the broker name. So for instance here, we have to specify the name of our broker. It has to be correctly. So ours is our broker node dot mount local. So it's possible you might not find this, you might not get this error. For some reason, my own installation omitted this part, which is weird. Might be a bug, not too sure. Alright, so make sure we set the name to be, you know, name for the broken node. Make sure you leave this as is. Now we want to make sure that the password for the, you know, for the authentication is set correctly. So for in this case, I'm going to leave this window open, and I'm just going to go ahead and go into the root for the Ruby mCollective package. So I'm going to go ahead and go to the server, and what I'm looking for here is the password we use for mCollective, so Marionette. Basically, we want to make sure that it matches all the credentials. I'm not worried here because the user is the same as mCollective. And for the admin user, let's just check the documentation and see what they have to say about that. Okay, so hopefully, alright, so here I'm supposed to choose a password. For now, I'm just going ahead and I'm going to give it the same password, Marionette. So feel free to put anything you want here. Alright, so alright, I think that's the changes we need to do in the active XML file. The next one here is to modify the active MQJT realm properties file. So here I'm just going to go to the directory here, Jetty, copy the Jetty configuration file. Also, I noticed that the encoding was off earlier, so I was getting the messed up encoding. So I'm just going to go end of line and just copy that. And let's go ahead and rename this file as well. Okay, I'm going to paste the contents here. Alright, so hopefully this hopefully we don't have to modify anything here. Alright. And last but not least is to modify the JetTRM properties file, and you can do that by making a copy of that. So let's see, JetTRM.properties file. So JetTRM. Okay. So right, and I need to make sure that this one also I'm just going to cut this, take it back to documents so that we have a single location for our files. Okay, so let me set this to be the same with the Marionette password I created earlier. So right, the next thing we also want to make sure that ActiveMQ comes up during boot. So I'm going to do this, and you can add firewalls rules, but we've disabled the locate for us. So when I'm using the locate system config firewall option that we have, so just going to go ahead and start the ActiveMQ server. So hopefully, if everything works correctly, we should have. Okay, so let's look at the ActiveMQ log file. So let's see if that works. That worked correctly. Okay, so here we're having mismatch of our record is some matching. So let's see if we can tweak this. So store limit is here. You can see we have it set to 10 gigs basically. And the data directory here is just okay, this is 100 gig. Alright, so hopefully this will allow us to tweak the config, and you can see here that our stump is listening on broker node, this one. So let's go ahead and restart. The M Collective agent, if you will, or the client. So okay, and we can go ahead and check the log files, and now we can see that we don't have the you can see we have the client identity running successfully here. We're getting sent in broadcast message here, which is fine, but we're not getting the connection timeout error here. Alright, so hopefully that has fixed the problem for us. I'm just going to go ahead and ensure that we continue our old diagnostics now. Alright, so you can see it passed the check for the OpenShift, the M Collective. You can see the profile for the OpenShift node. 1.mu.local is set to small, so it means our ActiveMQ implementation is running. So like I said, I'm not sure why mine did not work during the installation, but hey, if you've had this problem, this is new for me, and I'm glad we had to kind of figure that out together. So here you can see that we're not using any districts, so this would be the next set of screencasts. So for now, once the old diagnostics runs completely, I think we are good to go. Since you've done quite a lot in this video and you've seen how I will troubleshoot my OpenShift installation as I install them. So please, if you have any comments, suggestions, please feel free to drop them in the comment box below. I would glad to help if you've encountered any problems. And I know I promised that we're going to check some of the OO install commands. Maybe it would be a good time to use the mcopen command. So here you can see we don't have any errors except for warnings. One of the warnings is because we're using a self-signed certificate. In this case, since it's going to be a lab environment, I really care less about this one. Of course, we can go ahead and uncomment this. So we can just use the command here to fix this warning. And this other one here is, in another screencast when we set up districts, this will go away eventually. All right, so we can go ahead and check that we have our installation sees our node. In this case, we have one node, and you can see it was successful. Please, if you run this command and you're having problems, ensure that your ActiveMQ sees your nodes. And you can run your OO diagnostics to ensure that you don't have any errors. All right, so see you in the next screencast, and have a nice day.